Good morning, and welcome to worship with Ascension Lutheran Church in beautiful Nelson, BC. Today is October 2nd and the 17th Sunday after Pentecost. Today is also the last Sunday that we celebrate the season of creation. The season of creation brings us days to renew and restore our commitments to God and creation. It's a time for deepening and expanding our work and our witness for climate justice and environmental care, especially as we witness climate-related disasters in our own country, particularly from Hurricane Fiona, and around the world. Today is also the Sunday of St. Francis of Assisi. St. Francis was a lover of God's creation, and particularly animals. Our service today features lots of animals, and even the pets of many of the people of Ascension. Today's worship service will also have hymns, lessons, prayers, special music, and a sermon. Some of us will gather at our newly dedicated church building. Some of us will worship through this video. Though we may be physically apart, we are together in spirit, and we're really glad you're here.
Good morning. We gather in the name of the Creator, the risen Son, and the sustaining Holy Spirit. Amen. Let us pray. Holy One, you spoke the word and all that is in heaven and on earth came to be. Your Spirit hovered over the primal elements and you brought forth life in immeasurable forms, including this our fragile earth, and we amongst its inhabitants. We praise you, Creator God. As our past is in you, so our hope for the future rests with you. As we have turned from your way, may we turn again to the warmth of your love. Through you, all things are brought to new life. Through you, we find the spirit and commitment to work for restoration of your creation. We praise you, Creator God. Great Creator, remind us of your goodness in creation and our place within it, that our lives may honor every creature in heaven and on earth, and under the earth and in the sea. As the air sings with songs of glory, as the water flashes with the silver of creation, as the forests burgeon with leaves for the healing of the nations, so may God's light and love fill our hearts and souls and minds. Amen.
When we're gloomy, we wonder if God has forgotten us. This uncertainty is nothing new, but it's vital to be honest, to claim our feelings, so that we can listen for answers. As we read in Habakkuk chapter 1, verses 1 to 4, and chapter 2, verses 1 to 4. The oracle that the prophet Habakkuk saw. O Lord, how long shall I cry for help, and you will not listen, or cry to you violence, and you will not save? Why do you make me see wrongdoing and look at trouble? Destruction and violence are before me, strife and contention arise. So the law becomes slack, and justice never prevails. The wicked surround the righteous, therefore judgment comes forth perverted. I will stand at my watchpost and station myself on the rampart. I'll keep watch to see what he will say to me and what he will answer concerning my complaint. Then the Lord answered me and said, write the vision, make it plain on tablets so that a runner may read it. For there is still a vision for the appointed time. It speaks of the end and does not lie. If it seems to tarry, wait for it. It will surely come. It will not delay. Look at the proud. Their spirit is not right in them, but the righteous live by their faith. Holy wisdom, holy word. Thanks be to God.
Hi there. This is the prayer of Saint Francis.
Make me a channel of your peace. Where there is hatred, let me bring your love. Where there is injury, your pardon, Lord. And where there's doubt, true faith in you. Make me a channel.
A church family brings behavior models to life. We discover that grace is to live life gently. But if we misjudge the trials that others have, We expect them to act in ways that expose our own impatience. Patience and tolerance inspire this letter of 2 Timothy chapter 1, verses 1 to 14. Paul, an apostle of Christ Jesus by the will of God, for the sake of the promise of life that is in Christ Jesus, to Timothy, my beloved child. Grace, mercy, and peace from God the Father and Christ Jesus our Lord. I am grateful to God, whom I worship with a clear conscience, as my ancestors did, when I remember you constantly in my prayers, night and day. Recalling your tears, I long to see you so that I may be filled with joy. I am reminded of your sincere faith, a faith that first lived in your grandmother Lois and your mother Eunice, and now, I am sure, lives in you. For this reason, I remind you to rekindle the gift of God that is within you through the laying on of my hands. For God did not give us a spirit of cowardice, but rather a spirit of power and of love and of self-discipline. Do not be ashamed, then, of the testimony about our Lord or of me, his prisoner, but join with me in suffering for the gospel, relying on the power of God who saved us and called us with a holy calling, not according to our works, but according to his own purpose and grace. This grace was given to us in Christ Jesus before the ages began, but it has now been revealed through the appearing of our Savior Christ Jesus, who abolished death and brought life and immortality to light through the gospel. For this gospel I was appointed a herald and an apostle and a teacher, and for this reason I suffer as I do. But I am not ashamed, for I know the one in whom I have put my trust, and I am sure that he is able to guard until that day what I have entrusted to him. Hold to the standard of sound teaching that you have heard from me in the faith and love that are in Christ Jesus. Guard the good treasure entrusted to you with the help of the Holy Spirit living within us. May the church hear what the Spirit is saying. Amen.
Chapter 17, verses 5 to 10. The apostles said to the Lord, "Increase our faith." The Lord replied, "If you had faith the size of a mustard seed, you could say to this mulberry tree, 'Be uprooted and planted in the sea,' and it would obey you. Who among you would say to your slave who has just come in from plowing or tending sheep in the field, 'Come here at once and take your place at the table'? Would you not rather say to him, 'Prepare a supper for me, put on your apron and serve me while I eat and drink. Later you may eat and drink.' Do you thank the slave for doing what was commanded? So you also, when you have done all that you were ordered to do, say, 'We are worthless slaves. We have done only what we ought to have done.'" The Gospel of the Lord. Praise to you, O Christ. Well, as wonderful as it must have been to see Jesus perform miracles and to sit at Jesus' feet, hearing Jesus teach, do you ever feel sort of sorry for his disciples? After all, even the religious scholars and officials who were constantly challenging Jesus could not fully grasp his lessons. Jesus also keeps on asking them to do some pretty difficult things, like give away all of their possessions, forgive the wrongdoings of other people countless times, or take up their cross to follow him. Huge crowds are gathering. People are constantly coming to Jesus to seek healing, and opponents are always seeking answers from him. And the long shadow of the cross is hovering over this entire journey, leading Jesus to Jerusalem. If the disciples think that their faith needs a boost now, how will they feel when they must handle that? Well, we already know when Jesus is arrested and crucified, most of the disciples run away out of fear, or they hide themselves in the upper room, and then they go back to fishing. They assume that that chapter of their life has now come to an end. Without help or guidance, they are quickly and totally overwhelmed. So who amongst us can really blame Jesus' disciples for feeling like they aren't measuring up to the challenge? It is sometimes hard to believe, as much as we would like to or feel as though we should. In those times, it might feel as though our faith is on the line, both because it's being challenged, but also because we have never needed it more. So just like the disciples, we cry out to Jesus to increase our faith. When the disciples recognize their own need and they make their earnest and heartfelt plea to Jesus for help, you would think that Jesus would both welcome and grant such a request. But instead, he almost seems to rebuke them a little bit, telling them, if you had even a speck of faith, you could command a tree to jump in a lake, and it would do it for you. Well, this story reminds me of my first trip to the grocery store after moving to Saskatoon. It was a nice spring day, and so after finishing my shopping, I decided to walk home to my apartment. What I didn't realize was the equivalent of 3 miles, while I would be carrying 6 heavy bags of groceries. And pretty soon, my shoulders were aching. As I wove my way through the streets and avenues of my new neighborhood, I found myself walking past a building with a prominent sign out front reading, Church of Jesus Christ of Latter-day Saints. Well, at that time, I didn't know very much about any kind of faith community. I had not grown up attending church regularly. However, I had grown up watching plenty of television commercials that showed people from that particular denomination changing the flat tires of strangers in the rain and doing other good deeds. So frustrated by my heavy burden and my own poor planning, I set my bags down, looked skyward, and angrily demanded, well, where are they now when I need them? Well, as if on cue, the front doors of that building opened up and about 100 people poured out onto the lawn. And I'll never know if they would have helped me to get my groceries home, because I swiftly picked up my bags and I nearly ran away. I was so frightened. Who among us hasn't done something similar at one point or another, whether it appeared to work or not? As kids, we often wonder what we can command God to do. However, faith isn't a party trick. Asking Jesus to increase our faith makes faith about us and what we want, not about God and what God wants. Faith can't be measured with a dipstick or a ruler or by the pound or the cupful, especially in the world in which we are living now. If having some of something is good, having more of that same thing can only be better. However, when it comes to faith, we can't just ask Jesus to upsize it. The problem is the question. The disciples are thinking about faith all wrong. We tend to crave stories of heroic, costly, or extravagant leaps of faith with impressive results. However, most of our days on earth are spent humbly and faithfully carrying out our everyday tasks simply because they need to be done. We take meals out to the field during seeding and harvest. We change the light bulbs. We help the kids with their homework. And we pray for our neighbors in need. We change the parements. We put up the hymn numbers. And we make the coffee. And we hand out the bulletins at the church. We wait in hope, even when waiting is hard to do, for test results, for someone to arrive home safely, for better weather or for the morning to arrive through the long hours of a sleepless night. As Jesus points out, the servants aren't invited to the table alongside the landowner. They eat when their work is done. Servants don't deserve praise simply for doing their job. They just do it. The Catechism tells us that faith is a gift from God. I believe by my own reason or strength that I cannot believe in Jesus Christ or come to him, but the Holy Spirit has called me by the gospel, enlivened me with his gifts, sanctified and kept me in the true faith. Jesus compares faith to a mustard seed, the tiniest of all seeds, the same seed which Jesus compares the beginnings of God's kingdom to. And he tells us that when it comes to faith, size doesn't matter. The faith which we already have is more than enough. Sometimes it's easier to notice what we think that we are missing than to recognize the gifts that we have already been given. Jesus tells the disciples and us to take a second look and to realize that the miraculous presence of God is already all around us. The things in this world that we sometimes place our faith in, our own abilities, our money, other people, have all been gifts to us from God. God has brought us together in this place, calling us to serve God as best we can with the gifts we have been given for the purpose of building up Christ's church. That is what discipleship is. Every day we see news reports of more shootings, more injustice, more war. Yet all around us are also signs of God continuing to love and care for this world, even and especially through the simple and even unexciting acts of faithfulness that each of us are already doing. As much as we may feel at times that we are not up to the task that God has laid before us, God gives us all things, even the faith to believe and trust in God's guidance and provision for us. Paul, in his letter to Timothy, talks about the heritage of faith. Like Timothy, whose grandmother Lois and mother Eunice raised and instructed him in the faith, each of you likely can think of people who were your role models, teaching you to trust in God. They might be people who you knew as a child, such as your parents, your grandparents, your pastors, and your teachers. Or perhaps they are the friends and neighbors who you worship with today. These people may have an extraordinary story to tell about their faith journey. More likely, they are much like the household servant in today's gospel lesson. Regular people who did their daily work, but also knew where to place their faith. Part trust, part knowledge, part following. Faith is the firm foundation underneath everything that makes life worth living. Faith can't be reduced to a few steps. It's a way of life, the walk of a lifetime, one day at a time.
Most often, during our worship services, we use the Apostles' Creed as a statement of faith. At times, we use other statements of faith to affirm what we believe. These are reminders of what we are called to live as followers of Jesus Christ and how God works in our lives. During this season of creation, you are invited to join me in saying this alternate statement of faith by Janet Morley. O God, the source of our being and the goal of all our longing, we believe and trust in you. The whole earth is alive with your glory, and all that has life is sustained by you. We commit ourselves to cherish your world and to seek your face. O God, embodied in a human life, we believe and trust in you. Jesus, our brother, born of the woman Mary, you confronted the proud and the powerful and welcomed as your friends those of no account. Holy wisdom of God, firstborn of creation, you emptied yourself of power and became foolishness for our sake. You labored with us upon the cross and have brought us forth to the hope of resurrection. We commit ourselves to struggle against evil and to choose life. O God, life-giving Spirit, Spirit of healing and comfort, of integrity and truth, we believe and trust in you. Warm-winged Spirit, brooding over creation, rushing wind and Pentecostal fire, we commit ourselves to work with you and to renew our world. Amen.
This is the day in which we commemorate St. Francis of Assisi, who was a remarkable individual living almost 1,000 years ago, who recognized the presence of God in all of life and in the world. And on this particular day, we commemorate the way in which St. Francis recognized something of the Spirit of God in the animals, the other living beings, the creatures of the world. So let us give thanks and praise for the gift of animals in our lives. Let us pray. Blessed are you, Lord God, maker of living creatures, all living creatures. You called forth fish in the sea, birds in the air, and animals on the land. You inspired St. Francis to call all of them his brothers and sisters. We give thanks for the gift of life in creation, for wild animals, for domestic animals, for animals that share our homes and lives. On this day, we ask you to bless our beloved pets, living or remembered, those whom we name before you now, aloud or in our hearts. By the power of your love, Creator God, enable all creatures to live according to your plan. Bless the animals in our lives who have brought love and joy into our homes. Help us ever to praise you for all of your beauty in creation, and to give thanks for the treasured gift of pets and animals in our lives. Blessed are you, Lord our God, in all your creatures. Amen. And these words of prayer and thanksgiving are with a whiff of skunk in the air around our house at this moment.
As scattered grains of wheat are gathered together into one bread, so let us gather our prayers for the church, for those in need, and for all of God's good creation. With the words, God of grace, you are invited to respond. Hear our prayer. We pray for your holy church in every place and for those who serve following the example of Christ, especially BC Bishop Kathy and our interim pastor, Brenda. Help them to live by faith and walk by the light of your gospel. God of grace, hear our prayer. For parts of the world ravaged by natural disaster, especially Eastern Canada, Florida, Pakistan, relieve those affected by floods, wildfires, droughts, earthquake, tornado, and hurricanes. God of grace, hear our prayer. For every nation and for those entrusted with authority, grant our leaders self-discipline in all things and inspire them with love for your people, that they may negotiate peace for our world. God of grace, hear our prayer. For victims of violence, abuse, and neglect, heal those who have been harmed and protect those who are vulnerable. For all who are sick, especially Clementine, Pete, Marianne, David, Anne, Gwen, God of grace, hear our prayer. For this and every congregation, rekindle your gifts within your people and inspire councils, committees, and individuals to plan and work together that all may know your love. We pray for our sister congregations today, Spirit of Life Lutheran in Vancouver and Pastor Anita Sarup, and North Thompson Ecumenical Shared Ministry in Barrier and Reverend Bruce Chalmers. God of grace, hear our prayer. We stand in wonder and awe and thanksgiving for all of your creation, especially animals, domestic and wild. Keep us vigilant in protecting wild habitats. Keep us dutiful in providing for animals entrusted to our care. Make us ever aware of our role in working toward climate justice for all of your creation. God of grace, hear our prayer. Be with us as we live our mission as a community of Christians, empowered by the grace of God through word and sacrament, to do justice, to love kindness, and to walk humbly with God. Gathered together in the sweet communion of the Holy Spirit, gracious God, we offer these and all our prayers to you, through Jesus Christ, our Savior. Amen.
Please join me in saying the Lord's Prayer. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. Save us from the time of trial and deliver us from evil. For the kingdom and the power and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen.
Now on this day, may God, who has brought us all into being, who has created us, loves us, and daily cares for us, bless you. And may Father, Son, and Holy Spirit be and abide with you, now and always. Amen.
Better's are for us, God's light goes before.